This is WBSM On Demand. Come.
It's time for South Coast Now with Chris McCarthy. Streaming live on WBSM.com and the WBSM app. Call 508-996-0500. Text us using app chat on the WBSM app. Now, Chris McCarthy.
Good morning. It's a little overcast out there, but you can almost feel the summer in the air, you know. It won't be long. We'll be frolicking in the ocean and going boating and all that good stuff. But until then, we'll just be doing this. So last night, as the news was reporting, we had you had a vote in the New Bedford City Council on the Business Investment District. I had the architect of that, Marco, in here yesterday to talk about it for an hour. Quite frankly, it's been kicking around for years, really, in some form or fashion. It finally came to a head last night, and what an embarrassing night for the city of New Bedford. What an absolute embarrassment. We'll talk more about that over the next couple hours. It's all kind of coming together now, figuring out sort of what happened, some maybe the outside influences that were involved. It was really a bad, my opinion, a bad night for New Bedford. You had one of the city councilors calling Marco and the whole group, the steering committee, a cult. Literally saying, this looks like a cult to me. This looks like a cult to me. It was the most bizarre meeting I've ever seen. It was really bizarre. Now, those are my comments. Joining me here in studio is someone who's an advocate for the business investment district, Jay Lanagan. Jay, good morning. How are you?
Good morning, Chris. I'm doing well. How are you?
I'm doing really well. So, Jay, tell the people at home who may not know you who you are, what you do, all that stuff.
Again, Jay Lanagan. I presently live in Fairhaven, but for the past 20 years or so, I've been working and living at times in downtown New Bedford. And I've been a part of several developments. You know, some people may recognize Rose Alley is one that folks are familiar with. And then just, you know, several other, you know, buildings, commercial buildings, residential developments. I was the president of Downtown New Bedford, Inc. for a year or two. And I've been involved with leasing many of those properties and selling many of those properties and helping folks buy many of those properties. So I've been working in Downtown New Bedford committedly and extensively for about 20 years. And one correction, Chris, it's the Business Improvement District.
Oh, that's a Business Improvement District.
And I should also note that I'm sort of a quasi-advocate. I'm not on the steering committee.
Right.
I'm just a guy that's down there and entrenched in the business kind of community.
You spoke last night in favor. You talked about your own transition from being opposed to these kind of things to being in favor of it now. Explain that.
So about 10 years ago when New City America came into town and started talking a bit about a business improvement district, it was a concept that we had been exploring and kicking around already. Okay. But at the time, I believed that it wasn't necessary or that it may have been too expensive given the economic climate of downtown New Bedford. So, you know, 10 years ago or 15 years ago, fair market rents for commercial properties and residential properties, but primarily commercial properties, were well below other cities and towns in the Commonwealth, right? Most of the leases were gross leases. They weren't triple net leases, which are more professional and I would say valuable lease structure for a community and a landlord.
Triple lease is taxes, insurance.
And taxes, insurance, rent. And common area maintenance, right? It's just a more efficient way to operate a building. But most of the fees are passed through to a tenant in that structure versus a gross lease where the landlord takes on all the expenses. So, you know, just for a quick example, if you have if you're a landlord and you have a tenant paying $1,000 a month and your tax bill is $5,000 a year, if that bill goes to $6,000 a year and the tenant's rent stays at $1,000 a month, the landlord loses $1,000 a year and their property is subsequently devalued because of that. Under a triple net lease structure, that increase in taxes would be passed through to the tenants and the investor or the property owner would maintain their cash flow and as well as their property value. So 10 years ago, 15 years ago, the real estate taxes, commercial real estate taxes compared to the rents were too high. They were the reason why buildings were selling for the same amount of money time after time was because the rents weren't increasing enough to keep up with the increase in taxes.
Okay.
10 or 15 years later, 2024, right? Rents are up. Residential rents are up. Commercial rents are up. Taxes have climbed, but rents have actually risen, I believe, faster than the taxes have.
Okay.
And property values are up. So for that reason, that's one of the reasons why I've changed my mind a little bit.
Okay.
Is that contrary to what some of the support stated is that, you know, some of the support said property values haven't risen and this is going to help property values go up. I disagree with that. Property values have risen substantially in the past 10 years, as well as the rise of the triple net lease structure, which is good for the district. It's good for any city. It's a professional way to manage your commercial real estate.
Okay.
So because of that, because of those two points, I think that we may now be able to afford it. Whereas before we really couldn't afford another tax under a gross lease structure in a depressed rental market. So that's one of the reasons. But the main reason is that downtown New Bedford now is not what it was before the pandemic.
Okay,
the Zeiterion is closed.
Yeah.
And the Zeiterion was the number one draw to downtown New Bedford. Every time there was a show, there was an influx of people that came into the city and they spent money on parking. They spent money in restaurants. They spent money in retail shops. They just spent money. They got hotel rooms, whatever it was. The Z is closed and they're under a major renovation, which is fantastic for them and the district in the future.
Okay.
That's going to take a long time. That's going to take years. Okay. Star Store's gone, right? For whatever reason.
Whatever reason.
It's gone. Okay. And those artists are displaced and they are finding homes and nooks and crannies throughout the downtown, which is sort of cool.
All right.
But it's a little stressful.
Okay.
And I get that. And I'm sort of caught in the middle between being involved with the larger property owners in the work that I do.
Mm-hmm.
And then also having relationships with the artists and the small businesses in the work that I do and through friendships. I'm sort of caught in the middle.
Sure.
But because downtown's identity has been stripped a little bit because of the pandemic, the loss of the Star Store, the Zeiterion's closing, now is the time that we need to shape the direction of the district moving forward, I think, in our own words. The city's doing an excellent job with Explore New Bedford.
Okay.
City of the Office of Tourism and Marketing came out with a new campaign and they nailed it.
Right.
But that's from the city's point of view. It would be nice, or I think powerful and effective, for the taxpayers and the stakeholders, the small business owners, the artists, the residents, whom may have experience and skill sets that are beneficial to the bid, that would be able to tell the next chapter of the district in a way that would be appealing to people regionally or nationally to start bringing people back into downtown New Bedford on a consistent basis post-pandemic.
So we're speaking with Jay Lanagan. He's a involved with the BID district that was tabled last night. It was moved to June. People want more answers to some of the questions they had. Now, they've had months. I think the packet was there 2 months ago for them to look at. I know that one of the counselors said, I just got this. And I thought, no, you didn't. I've been looking at this thing for months. So if I've been looking at it, the city council has. Certainly had the option to, I guess is what I'm saying. It was a bizarre meeting, my words. I don't think was good for the city of New Bedford as an investment community, but they have an opportunity to turn it around in June.
Yeah, I think we were talking off air before that the most disheartening part about that meeting for me was that nobody was on the same page,
right?
At all, and I think, you know, in the crowd, some folks started chatting a little bit, you know, supporters and opposition to say like, hey, if this thing goes through, you know, you're going to have to be on the board. You know, you're going to be on the board. All right, let's do this. So there was some constructive conversation happening, you know, out in the hall and, you know, all of those like sort of theatrical city, you know, meetings, you know, things, which were cool. But that didn't translate into the meeting. And, you know, there are legitimate concerns. Totally. There are risks associated with a bid, and I'm fully aware of those risks. And I think, you know, those risks really come down to, like, you know, is it going to work?
Right.
Is it going to be a waste of money? Are there going to be special interests that people are afraid of, that they're not going to be represented? You know, and you know, I was listening to some of my colleagues and peers that own small businesses down there and that I work with on other projects. And their biggest concern was, you know, is this going to be taxation without representation? My friend Brandon said it, you know, and that's why it's important for folks to get on the board. And frankly, those are the people that should be on the board because they're the ones that bring the most to the table.
Mm-hmm.
And if they're able to guide the direction of a marketing campaign, a PR campaign, an idea for a market study, could, you know, talk about the need for more affordable housing or the need for more market rate housing or the need for more X, Y, or Z, and then be able to have the resources available to explore that hypothesis and then be able to present it to the city council or the city to say, hey, listen, we have an idea that may help this district.
Right.
We've taken it a step further and hired a third party, you know, unbiased, you know, market study firm to explore it. And here are the findings,
right?
You know, so this, a bid can do so much if you have everybody on the same page.
Yeah.
So, you know, there was a lot of conversation and there were those concerns are valid. But there is, and we were talking about it in the hallway where there is a leap of faith that everyone has to take to say, we're going to try this out.
Right.
This could work out really well if we all get together and we consider everyone's point of view and needs. But everyone has to get together to do that. And right now it's disjointed.
The one thing I saw in the room or from home, you know, I was watching on television, but I've been in government meetings and I've been around entrepreneurs. You had a lot of entrepreneurs in the room trying to do something and they had to get people who aren't entrepreneurs to sign off on it, government people. So you have people who've never been entrepreneurs who've been elected to office, and that's okay. You need a mix of people, certainly, in government, who have never probably taken a leap of faith, right? In other words, you've taken a leap of faith. Jay, I've known you really my whole life. You've taken a lot of leaps of faith. There's no guarantees in what you do. No guarantees in what any of us do.
No, not at all.
But you, when you buy a building, you don't go, oh, I know this is going to work, right? I mean, it's a leap of faith.
It's a leap of faith every time. And I work with people that are buying buildings, you know, and they're and they're looking at it and they're calculating the ROI and the cost that it's going to take to renovate it, and you know, how much can I bring in for leases and in revenue and so on and so on. And at a certain point, you have to say, I'm just going to do it and I'm going to make it work.
Right.
And this is similar to that, yes. Where it's like, we're going to do this. We're going to make it work. We're going to put the right board together that is representative of the entire district,
right.
Including residential renters, small business owners, artists, nonprofits, and large landowners.
Right.
Right. Everybody. So, and then we're going to make it work for the district.
Right.
And then we're going to measure it. And if it works over the long haul, we're going to do it again. And if it doesn't, we're going to dismantle it.
So that's the thing, is that it got really complicated last night, in my opinion. And it didn't have to be, because basically what it is a geographical location. Everybody pays a little bit more to the district than that money is the landowners anyway. And then the money is used for marketing.
Well, That's a great point. And that was sort of where I think the city council and opposition and supporters sort of got derailed.
Yeah.
In the sense that there was confusion regarding who pays, right. And who's in. And the way it is structured now is the largest landowners and property tax payers with the largest assessments, right? Yeah. Those are the ones that are paying in. So the wealthy are paying in. And then everybody else gets to use those tax dollars as they see fit on the board,
right.
To enhance their businesses, really primarily,
right.
But also enhance their residential construction projects, their nonprofit events, and so on. But it's to enhance the district's performance and bringing people into the district, which will primarily help small businesses the most, in my opinion.
Yeah.
Right. And those are the folks that are paying rent to the landlords. So it's sort of this nice ecosystem if it's done properly.
Right. And it's been done in 94 other cities. That's the other thing, is that unlike people who are just trying it out for the first time, Marco and his team have done it in 94 cities all over the country. So when you're going to take a leap of faith, it's not a bad guy to take a leap of faith with, in my opinion. Anyway, folks, we have Jay Lanagan here in studio. If you'd like to get involved, you can at 508-996-05. We're going to be talking about this for the rest of the day, because really it was a monumental decision last night. It's going to get another look. You'll come back in June. To what happens in June is really anyone's guess at this moment. But folks, stick around. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the show. I'm Chris McCarthy. We have Jay Lanagan, who's a member of the downtown business community and also the Fairhaven business community. He's involved in quite a bit of projects around the area. Talk about the housing type stuff. Last night we heard a lot about gentrification. Okay, talk about that.
Yeah. So gentrification in a city like New Bedford is always a concern, and I think, in my line of work, which are, you know, real estate related matters, we are seeing a lot of people that are being displaced in regards to housing. That is a real issue. So it's totally warranted for city councilors to check that whenever there is something happening like this. But I think it's important to note that in this proposed bid district, there are several substantial housing projects that are underway. I mean, under construction, millions of dollars are being spent. And the biggest ones on Union Street that are under construction are primarily rent-restricted housing projects. So meaning the rent is controlled.
Right.
And, you know, 80 to 90%, I believe, of those units, which are about 80 units,
right.
Are are controlled. They're restricted. They are essentially rent controlled. It exists,
right.
And it's being practiced in, you know, not just in theory. It's happening. So
it's the financing is linked to it, right?
100%. They are for 30 years restricted affordable apartments.
Right.
Now, that's not the only type of housing that we need to build. Mm-hmm. You know, I think once you wrap your head around the concept that as a society, we have to provide housing to absolutely everyone.
Okay.
We have to feed absolutely everyone, and we have to educate absolutely everyone. And that's why I'm an independent, right? There's some lines that are, you know, get blurred there in political conversation. But that is my belief, if you want to move the society forward. And once you understand that you have to house everybody, then you start to look at housing and housing development a little bit differently. And in a city like New Bedford, you have to build all types of housing all of the time. So it's wonderful.
Are tents adequate?
They are not.
Okay.
Those are the problems. But and it's just, it comes down to stability. You know, you need to give everybody stability so that they can thrive in whatever point they are in their life.
Okay.
But it's great that they're building largely rent-restricted apartments. Now, affordable apartments are different than, say, public housing, right? In the sense that, you know, the folks that live in truly workforce, you know, housing units are held to the same rental standards as the folks that are renting luxury high-end apartments. It's, you know, credit checks, background checks, rental history.
You and I have talked about this, that you say, look, it really is about not the income, but about the tenant and who manages it, how you manage it, how you screen them, right?
Correct. You know, so so it's great that we're building rent-controlled units in the bid district, but we also need to build market-rate housing. We need to build luxury housing. We need to build accessible housing for folks with disabilities. Like, we have to build housing for everyone.
Right.
But the idea that the bid district is going to be gentrified as a result of, you know, pooling a few hundred thousand dollars together to market the district professionally, to advocate for the district professionally, to hire safety potentially for the district professionally, I just don't think it's a reality. The concern is valid.
Yes.
But in practice, the real estate developers in downtown New Bedford are building anti-gentrification housing.
Right.
Presently.
Right. Because the financing, so people understand this, rent control gets very confusing. The financing is obtained with the legal restrictions on what the developer can charge, correct?
Correct. So a one bedroom apartment, market rate, right? There are some market rate apartments in New Bedford that are going for $2,000 for a one bedroom, right? They exist. An affordable apartment that's restricted, you know, through the financing and through the Office of Housing and Community Development would go for something closer to $1,350.
Okay.
So there's a substantial difference, and, you know, the guidance or the amount that the landlord can charge every year is put out by the state based on the area median income. And that's what most of those units are. So we are building housing so that folks aren't displaced. Folks are being displaced because they're living in market rate housing that has been serving an affordable need for decades.
Right.
So it's sort of a black market of low income housing.
Yeah.
But those units aren't restricted. So anybody, any investor, anybody can buy those units and charge whatever the market can bear,
right.
Versus building a project that is financed with LIHTC, low income housing tax credit, or the affordable housing tax credit, or workforce housing tax credit. They're all the same.
Okay.
And they are restricted, meaning that they cannot raise the rent too high. So the displacement is happening because we haven't built or utilized affordable housing across the city correctly. And there's no reason why a landlord shouldn't be able to buy a building for X amount of dollars and charge whatever they have to charge to pay their mortgage and maintain the property and pay their insurance and do all of those things. So as long as those folks that legitimately need affordable housing have a place to go.
Okay. It doesn't have to be the same building, though.
It does not.
Right. Right. In other words, everything doesn't have to be affordable housing or market rate. It's not going to be either.
No.
So making that a standard is a ridiculous attempt, right?
Correct. You need to have housing for everybody.
Right.
So it's not fair to say you can only build affordable housing, and then if somebody comes in with a W-2 that's too high, mm-hmm. you can't say, well, you can't live here.
Right.
You can't live in our community. You make too much money.
Right.
We want them too. We want everybody to come into downtown if they want to live there and have options.
So what ended up happening last night, folks, for those who weren't at or didn't see the meeting, is that it got to this conversation that is a valuable conversation, but it was, I think, being had with the wrong people at the wrong time. In other words, this is about a simple marketing plan, quite frankly. They want to make the streets a little cleaner. They want to pay for it themselves. They want to market the district. They want to pay for it themselves. They want to have a continuous stream of income so that you can fund it. They want funding, but they're not going to get it from the taxpayers. They're going to get it from each other. I mean, I think that got lost somewhere in the conversation last night.
Yeah, I mean, the assessment, right? They like to, you know, it's nicer to say assessment than tax. It's right. a tax. It's right. an increase in your taxes. And that's another point is that I think for a while, the conversation was on should the city collect the money or should the bid collect the money?
Right.
And the city should collect the money because a bid, which is, you know, a volunteer board primarily, right? We're trying to keep the payroll as low as possible.
Yes.
Should not be in the business of billing and collecting assessments from property owners.
Right.
That would eat up a lot of the funds.
Yes.
A lot of the time. And it would potentially be a disaster. Whereas if the city collected the fee with its taxes, it would be more efficient and more folks would pay and the money would go to the bid more routinely and be able to be, you know, put to work, you know, quicker. I did want to mention that it was tabled and some of the city councilors were sort of talking about it. You know, Ian was talking to us about tabling it because it was clear that there were a lot of questions that needed to be answered and that rushing a vote may not have been in the best interests of anybody in the room, even the opposition. I think there are some folks in there that were opposed to it, but sort of into the idea, but weren't ready to take the leap of faith.
Right.
So tabling it, I think, was appropriate because it'll give everybody enough time to maybe work through some of these questions and, you know, get to the point where they may want to take the leap of faith and say, all right, let's try to do something special here.
We have Jay Lanagan here in studio. We'll take this phone call. Good morning. Thanks for calling.
Yeah, good morning, Chris. Good morning, Jay.
Good morning.
Good morning.
There's many layers to this housing problem. First of all, let me just point out by saying the foundation is jobs. You know, paying jobs that people can pay their rent. Because if you're unemployed or underemployed, you're not going to pay any kind of rent, no matter what. Secondly, the government has created its problems through subsidies for these rental properties. And so it's driving up the cost, plus illegal aliens. So there's many, many layers to this. But if we don't get jobs and industry in this city, you can build a skyscraper like in New York. Nobody's going to be able to afford it. And if all you're relying is on government subsidies, that's a losing proposition because those who have a property and are working are going to pay more taxes and they're going to be out in the cold with no house. I want your comments on that, Jay.
Thanks for the call, my friend.
Sure. I think you're right. I mean, you're talking about macroeconomics. You're talking about, supply and demand. And you can't build a skyscraper in New Bedford unless you can prove that there's the demand. So
right.
when you build a big building, you have to go to a bank and you have to say, listen, I'm going to put X amount of cash into this, and then I'm going to need to borrow X amount of cash from you guys to build this thing. And here is a market study supporting why there's a need for this skyscraper, and these are the industries and people that are going to fill up that building. Mm-hmm. If you don't have data that'll support the need to build that skyscraper, you're not going to build it, okay?
The bank's not going to give you the money.
Correct. The bank is not going to give you the money. Now, in New Bedford, right, not just downtown New Bedford, but in New Bedford, there is a need, there is a demand to build market rate housing and affordable housing, okay? There are plenty of market studies that support both initiatives. So there is industry in New Bedford. There are jobs in New Bedford.
Yes.
People work in New Bedford and around New Bedford, okay? And there is a higher demand than supply for all types of housing in my hands-on experience. So you can obtain the financing and the investment from the private market, folks with cash,
okay,
to build market rate and affordable housing. So, you know, and that's a good thing. So I think you're right in many ways, but it's not, I think, as simple as how you described it.
508-996-0400. We're going to take a quick break. We have Jay Lanagan here in the studio, but of course you got to get the building permits.
Yes, you do.
You got to get the building permits. All right, folks, stick around. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the show. I'm Chris McCarthy. We have my friend Jay Lanagan here in studio. So you work not just in New Bedford, though.
Correct.
What other communities are you in?
I work all throughout the South Coast. You know, we do some work in Rhode Island, but it's primarily South Coast, Western Mass, a little, you know, Boston, north of Boston. But most of our hands-on development projects are, you know, here in greater New Bedford.
508-996-0500 so you can get on the program. Good morning. Thanks for calling.
Good morning, gentlemen.
Hi.
Hi.
Hi, Jay. How many buildings were you looking to build? Or are these buildings already there that you want to occupy? And when you mean market rate, is that something like the Manomet? Is that considered a market rate?
Thanks for the call.
I'm not familiar with the Manomet, and I don't have a specific target in terms of how many, you know, buildings that I want to build. You know, I work with, you know, developers and partners to help them acquire or sell and sometimes develop, you know, a property that they're holding, you know, into mixed-use development. So it could be commercial on the first floor with some retail or a restaurant,
right?
And then, you know, residential upstairs that could include a mix of affordable and market rate housing. So and those projects are market driven. So it's, you know, in some years the phone rings more than others,
right?
But you know, we stay busy, and these projects take a long time, and it's really important, I think, for folks to understand how much time, you know, a project takes. A substantial housing project could take, you know, upwards of 10 years
right,
to do from its inception to its completion and lease out. And along the way, you need investors that have the capacity and capital to wait that long and continue to fund projects, you know, through their ups and downs and speed bumps and problems and unforeseen conditions and so on. And also folks that have the ability to hang in there with the economy and the political environment. So there's a lot of risk that goes into development, and it is market driven. So we don't come in and say, we want to build 10 apartments or 10 buildings in this area. And
right.
That's just not how it goes.
508-996-0500. We have Jay Lanagan here in the studio. We're having an expansive discussion based around the fact that the Business Improvement District, which is the downtown area, was tabled last night. It's going to come back up in June by the City Council. and all the ramifications that come from that. Let's go back to the phones. Good morning. Thanks for calling.
Hey, good morning, gentlemen. How's it going?
Good morning.
Hey, first of all, I want to thank Jay for coming on and kind of enlightening us to what's going on, because clearly he has vast experience in the area and he's put his money where his mouth is. So I appreciate that. But one question that I did have is, besides like the financial aspect of getting the loans, so on and so forth, what do you think is the biggest obstacle working or trying to develop here in the city of New Bedford?
That's a great question. I joke about it all the time because, you know, I may not be the right guy to ask because I have had a great experience working with the city of New Bedford. I've been doing it for about 20 years. When I came in, I was in my 20s and I was learning on the fly.
Yep.
And Nick Nanopoulos was heading up licensing at the time. And, you know, I would come in with applications and put them on his desk and he would, you know, mark them up like a third grade English teacher and send them back and say, go fix this and bring it back, you know, and he wasn't nice about it.
Okay.
And, you know, but he trained me on how to submit a very, very clean licensing application.
Okay.
So that was a great experience for me.
Sure.
You know, in running around the city trying to get permits, you know, from planning or inspectional services or DPI, right? You know, I've had a good experience in the sense that I've always been able to get my permits, but that was because I've always shown up, given those offices what they asked for, mm-hmm. said please and thank you, understood that they're very busy.
Right.
They have a job to do, that it's not necessarily the person at the desk who is putting you through this lengthy process,
right.
You know, or it's not really the boards that are trying to give you a hard time.
There's
a man
behind the curtain.
There are ordinances and there are statutes and there are rules and regulations, and you just have to go in saying, hey, I'm going to be upfront and honest about what I'm trying to do and provide whoever is at the desk with whatever information they need to feel comfortable giving me whatever permit I need. And if you approach the permitting process like that in any city and town,
right.
in Massachusetts, Rhode Island, or anywhere else in this country, more often than not, you're going to get your permit. And I say that because that has been my experience in all of the cities and towns. Have we batted 1,000? No. Have the municipalities batted 1,000? No. But the majority of the time, we've been able to get what we needed in a timely manner and in a respectful way.
508-996-0400. We have Jay Lanagan here in the studio. We're kind of talking, expanding discussion basically around what happened last night in the city council. The business improvement district. We'll stick around. We'll be right back. Welcome back. I'm Chris McCarthy, and we have Jay Lanagan here for a few more minutes talking about the Business Investment District. So, are you optimistic for June's meeting?
I have no idea. I mean, that was an incredible meeting.
Wasn't it?
I've been doing this for 20 years. I've never been in a meeting that went on that long.
Right.
I mean, it was past 10 o'clock when I left there. But
it got weird.
It got weird, but you know, you have to sit back and say, you know, why did it get weird? And it got weird because people feel very strongly about this issue. And, you know, the city councilors had great questions. They were very direct, you know, in their assessment of what was going on.
They're the only people in the room who've been elected to represent everybody. So they have a franchise, right? I mean, they everyone else has to ask their permission because they're the representative of the people. So you got to respect that.
100%.
Right.
And it was just one of those things that it could have gone on forever. Wanted to just continue to talk about it until they understood it. And they wanted to pick it apart. And in my experience, you know, that sort of discourse only happens when something is big and has some value and could potentially be something, but needs to be handled very carefully. And people need to, at the very least, understand it.
Mm-hmm.
And last night, it was evident to me that there were lots of folks in the room that did not understand it.
Yes.
And didn't understand how it worked, didn't understand who was paying, didn't understand who could participate, it almost maybe sounded too good to be true, right? So they said, well, what's the catch?
Right.
You know, and I think some of the...
I agree with you. There was a lot of suspicious minds.
Yeah,
there were, right?
Some city councilors in there that were like, hey, I wasn't born yesterday. This doesn't add up.
Right.
And that's great. You know, I think it's great because that's exactly how I felt 10 years ago.
Yes.
And that's exactly how I came across 10 years ago. I didn't pull any punches either.
Right.
I said, hey, what is this? Who are you? This sort of sounds too good to be true. What's mm-hmm. the catch? You know, you're not going to put one over on me kind of thing. And but I spent the time to understand it. I identified the risks. And the risk is that it doesn't work. The risk is that there are special interests that take advantage of it.
Yeah.
But that's why you have to have a balanced board of stakeholders that will guide the ship to do, you know, what it can and should do. But it's a risk. It's a huge risk. But what do we have to lose?
Exactly.
Post-pandemic.
Right.
Not much.
Jay, we're done, and I really appreciate you for coming in. Thanks a lot. I've been trying to get him in here, folks, for a while. I think you'll agree that he's a valuable guest. He's been a valuable friend. So, Jay, again, thanks for coming in.
Thanks
I do appreciate
me.
It, and you're always welcome here. Folks, stick around. We're going to for the local news. Then we're going to have me back here for the next.